Should you buy a home only for self-use or to live in, or can you look at buying a residential property as a rental income asset? For years now, India's housing market has offered sub-optimum rental returns of 1-3%. There's been this sense of unease and distrust between landlords and tenants, and many property owners, including non-resident Indians, simply keep their property locked up rather than renting it out. The new Model Tenancy Act 2021 announced by the government promises to change that. Now let's see what it actually promises to both property owners or the landlords as well as the tenant. So first, the landlords, how are they protected? Tenants now cannot sublet a part or whole property to anybody else. There are heavy penalties on tenants if they refuse to vacate or refuse to pay rent. Now, on not vacating the premise or the property, the tenant will get a maximum of 6-month extension on the same lease agreement terms. But after that extension, the tenant will be liable to pay double the rent for 2 months, and after that, 4 times of the rent. So that's a heavy penalty. How are tenants protected? There's a maximum limit for security deposits fixed at 2 months for residential property and 6 months for commercial property. Rent cannot be increased during the agreement period or tenancy period unless stated so in the agreement. The property owner must give prior notice of 3 months before revising the rent in case he wants to do it in the middle or even towards the end of the agreement. No landlord can withhold any essential supplies, that's water, electricity, etc., to the property and premise. Tenants will not be evicted unless agreed by both the parties in writing. Now let's see that big clause on dispute resolution. So far, if you had a problem with your tenant, he was not vacating, or the tenant had a problem with the landlord, you needed to go to a civil court to resolve it. And those courts are overburdened. You could also go to consumer court. Now what the Model Tenancy Act has done is it set out a separate dispute mechanism which says that there will be rent authorities, courts and tribunals in every district which will only look at these kind of dispute resolutions, and therefore you should get much quicker resolutions to any problems. These are the highlights from the new Act and the questions we are asking on the Property Show today. Is this protection adequate for both the tenants and the property owners or the landlords? What are the implementation challenges of this model code, and whether these new laws will ensure that the 1 crore vacant homes across India will now get occupied? Joining me for the discussion, Niranjan Hiranandani, founder and MD of Hiranandani Group, Anshuman Magazine, chairman and CEO of India, Southeast Asia, Middle East and Africa at CBRE, and Yudhish Narayan, senior partner at YNS and Associates. I'm going to come to you, Mr. Hiranandani, first. What is the verdict? Does it adequately protect the property owners? Who would, you know, would they be encouraged to now rent out their homes?
I think this is a revolutionary move, something which is we wanted for a long period of time. Remember, the Prime Minister Awas Yojana in the urban areas is producing 1.1 crore houses. Here we have 1.1 crore houses already built and lying vacant with various people with a hesitancy to put into the market. The Model Tenancy Act is definitely the way forward in order to get this entire stock into the market, which will make a paradigm change to happen. People were reluctant to give their flats on tenancy because they were scared that they wanted it or the contract expired. They would not get the property back. I think this Tenancy Act certainly goes a long way in ensuring and creating necessary legal framework of tribunals and other agencies which will get this done very quickly. Right. But it has to be ratified by the states, and that's the question, whether all of them will do it quickly enough to make it happen.
All right, we'll come to the challenges and that question a little bit later. Anshuman Magazine, are we being too simplistic in saying that all these 1 crore homes which are lying vacant are, you know, were lying vacant simply because the property owners were not legally comfortable in renting them out? Isn't there a large amount of stock which is essentially not of a quality or in places which people do not want to rent them in?
Yes, certainly there is, Manisha. And but even let's say if we release, I'm saying 30%, I'm not even saying 50% of the stock in the market, it will really increase the supply of housing. So one of the ways to tackle affordable housing, we talk about, the first thing comes into mind, you have to own it, right? There is a big challenge for youngsters, for many people, especially since there has been a huge migration from rural to urban areas. And unlike 20, 30 years, people are moving from Delhi to Bombay, Bombay to Bangalore for work. There is a challenge for them to get good quality properties on rent. You are right that the many properties still will not come out because people have just put it under lock and key. But even if you take a small percentage of a huge number of residential houses, apartments, which are long-term currently in India, it will make a difference in the market.
Okay. Difference to the market. Mr. Hiranandani, does that mean that rents will come down further? Because rental yields in India is just between 1 and 3%, right? And if you have more stock, which means there would be pressure on rents, is that a possibility?
It could be, but I don't think so. Because the point is that these are houses where people have moved even to Jhopadpattis. Half of Mumbai lives in Jhopadpattis. They could easily afford rental housing if they could shift into homes and houses which would become affordable. This would be a different segment of the economy completely. So I do not think that the rental markets for new construction and new homes is going to come down by any which way. In fact, the market will expand and people will be happy to get things on rent. And with the IT and the internet system and e-commerce, it'll be possible to know where these are available, what is the quality of homes that is going to be there, what is the facility, and hence I think it will be a very vibrant rental market which is going to be created. So okay. I'm looking forward.
Anshuman, will developers come in now, build specifically to rent out? Because, you know, there's also this chatter that in a large project with many towers, perhaps developers will now start taking one tower and making it rental housing. Is that likely?
Yes, there's a lot of talk about that. I think it will take longer. At least the unsold inventory can be rented out. So that is, at least some non-performing asset is becoming performing to some extent, even if the yields are only 1 to 2% or 3% you mentioned, which is very low. But at least, you know, there is some income in sort of it being a non-performing asset. But for developers, and they will be, I've spoken to, in fact, some of the international institutions, also financial investors, are looking at putting rental housing like that, how it is in the mature markets. But I don't think there will be a big push towards that or rush towards it because the yields are too low. The good part is the interest rates have gone down, the cost of borrowing has gone down, but the land is still expensive. And in the right locations, the land is too expensive for getting that return. So I don't see there's a rush into building a rental housing, but there will be definitely more developers looking at this model, especially in certain cities where the yield is a bit higher than, let's say, 2% or 3%, where the borrowing cost for some of the developers is low. So yes, so there will be more, but it won't be like a rush because it's still the returns are too low.
All right. Let me come then to the issue of the implementation. Now, a lot of this depends, Yudhisht, on setting up of rent tribunals and authorities in every state. First of all, of course, states adopting it quickly enough. Do states have that capacity and manpower? I look at our legal system, it's overburdened. Do you think this will happen very quickly?
Manisha, when we look at the legislation itself, it's twofold. The first part is assigning the rights and obligations to landlords and tenants and ensuring that they have a very transparent relationship to set out the duties and obligations and set out the regulations under which they can rent out properties. The second part is that in the event a dispute arises, that these landlord tenant disputes are exclusively submitted to the courts established under this particular legislation. Earlier, you had the remedy of going to a civil court, or depending on the nature of your tenancy, you also had the remedy of going to a consumer forum. Now, this legislation specifically sets up a three-tier system. There's going to be an authority, thereafter there's going to be a court, and thereafter there's going to be an appellate tribunal. And these will exclusively try these matters, and hopefully it will lead to expeditious resolution of these disputes. However, I would like to caveat one thing, that the existing legislation that existed governing tenancy, whether the nomenclature lease or rental agreements, all those laws are still very much in place. So you have the Transfer of Property Act, read with the Stamp Act, read with the Registration Act. All of these legislations are very much in place. The Model Tenancy Act is more of a umbrella legislation which is above these, which lays down the definitive structure, as Mr. Hiranandani said, of the landlord-tenant relationship.
Okay, I still need a straight answer from you. Will people get quick resolution if they have a dispute with their landlords, let's say?
It depends completely on the implementation by the states. If the states tend to dilute the legislation or drag their feet like they did with RERA, and we've had a recent example, and that's why I'm bringing up RERA, then we can see some ambiguity coming in, and we can see that it will take some time before this legislation becomes effective.
Okay.
But if these states are quick and they bring the legislation in its true spirit, in pith and substance, then yes, this will have an effective role to play in landlord-tenant relationships.
Mr. Hiranandani, there was a lot of pushback on RERA from developers, particularly because they felt it was one-sided. Before that, buyers felt that everything was extremely against them. In this Model Tenancy Act, there should not be any issues for every state to just take it and, you know, implement the same laws in their states. They don't even need to modify it, actually.
Manisha, there will be some modification required. For example, in the case of Mumbai, we have the old tenancies where people are protected. I don't think this will be with retrospective effect. It is sought to be prospective. So a clarification will have to be issued, which is not there in the present law, that it will not be retrospective in action to old tenancies where people who cannot afford otherwise the new rental laws and things like that to be continued to do. But it is prospective, and this is what we were asking for. We have been saying that, and as you must be aware, in the United States of America, the richest country in the world, more than 50% people live their lives from birth to death in rental housing. So I think this is something where the confidence was not there, whether it is developers, whether it is institutions, companies and others. I agree with Anshuman, there's not going to be a rush to construct such things, but you will see a lot of people will construct. It may not be a flood and a tide, but I can assure you, my company would be interested, for example, the Hiranandani's would certainly look at rental housing with a positive frame of mind, though the numbers we don't know, but we'll certainly look at it positively, because we do believe that as it's not only the rental yield which is important, but also capital appreciation. With inflation being what it is, the property prices over a period of time have been growing tremendously, and we don't mind a lower rate of return if ultimately the asset value becomes valuable after 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. So automatically the total return, which is the rental yield plus capital appreciation, could be a good return for the purposes of holding the property. And that is my personal belief. Okay. I don't know how it will hold for the industry.
Well, I hope so. I hope to see some investments also coming in it. Though I feel that at this moment, with the returns looking quite limited, I doubt if there'll be a rush of any kind of capital.
Manisha,
maybe developers you will get into it.
I'm ready to invest.
All right. I'm glad to hear that you've made that commitment. Anshuman, any challenges that you see? Because the Model Act is fairly excellent in terms of trying to restore that confidence between landlords and tenants, which essentially has been missing, somewhat a legacy of the British Raj and our older Rent Control Acts, etc.
I think, like, one is, of course, challenge of implementation in states, etc. The other thing is what I'm a bit not happy about this Model Tenancy Act, although it's an outstanding act and will release housing for rental, is the limitations they put in. It may sound small, but it is significant that the landlord cannot take more than 2 months rent as deposit in residential, not more than 6 months for commercial. And I don't see any reason why government should be putting those restrictions, because these financials should be left to the market forces. And a lot of times, and Mumbai is a good example, but even in Why Mumbai? Because rental housing has been more mature there in other cities. But now you come, if you look at Gurgaon, Bangalore, everywhere, there's rental housing. And the deposit is a function of many things. It's a total package, financial package. You could pay higher deposit, lower rental, or vice versa. And same in commercial. So it should be left. And it could be that the market reaches a point where the deposit is lower than what it is. So I really feel that that should have been left to the market forces. And
not determined. You believe that, or you think that, I mean, I strongly believe that in a market, like I've seen young journalists struggling in Mumbai just because of that hefty deposit. And it's a huge burden. Why leave it to the markets? I mean, at least for residential, there has to be a limit set by states.
The Tenancy Act very clearly states that the Contract Act and the contract will still be sacrosanct between the landlord and the tenant. You know, it is going to be the ultimate document. What the Tenancy Act has done is it's put limits. And I feel that this should not have been dictated in terms, maybe they should have been guidelines which were indicative but should not have been binding. A contract is commercially decided between two people. Mm-hmm. And in the best case scenario, both the parties should benefit mutually, you know, from that contract. The moment you put an imposition on one of the parties by way of legislation or by way of statute, then the one of the parties is immediately limited. So I think this should have been left to be decided commercially between the parties.
Okay, so all of you are on one side. I think I can feel the pain of my colleagues a little bit more. But thank you so much, Mr. Hiranandani, Anshuman Magazine and Yudhish. Thank you for joining me on this discussion. Well, let's keep our fingers crossed that states implement the Model Tenancy Act in their states as well and union territories without making too much of a modification. It's a pretty good act and law as per se. When we come back, we speak to Ashwinder Raj Singh, the author of the book A to Z of Real Estate, to get his recommendations in what are the five most important things you must keep in mind before buying property. Buying a home or a property is one of the biggest financial investments and commitment for any Indian family. How does one ensure that you make the right decision when it comes to buying a home? We have with us Ashwinder Raj Singh, a real estate veteran and the author of a recently launched book, A to Z of Real Estate, which has been extremely well received by the markets. Ashwinder, you know, somehow it's culturally ingrained in us that one should own at least one property, and the pandemic has made us realize that value of a home even more. So what's your suggestion to home buyers who are sitting on, or let's just say consumers who are sitting on the fence? Should they go ahead and buy, looking at the fact that prices have gone nowhere, home loans are at an historic low, and what are the things they should keep in mind?
Thank you. First of all, thank you so much for getting me on your show, Manisha. I would also like to thank Arjun Agarwal for launching this book. And to answer your question, I've always maintained that it's always a good time to buy a home if you need one. The difference is whether you need one or you want one, but this is a very good time to buy a home. The issue is that the ready-to-move-in inventory in the market is completely finished. So it depends what your budgets are. In case you are getting into an under-construction home and you are still living on a rental home, you know, and rent combined with the EMI can become a little stressful, but the rate of interest are less. If you find the right developer in the location where you want, this would be a very good time. And actually, the home sales have been very high in the last 1 year after the pandemic. So people are realizing the importance of buying a home.
How do you balance that emotional and investment quotient? You said that do take a look at whether you really need a home. How do you balance it? I mean, if I still look at a spreadsheet, I think I would be better off not buying one, right? And just renting one today.
Actually, you are right. I truly believe in this question. Thank you for asking it. See, if you're living in a rent and the home is big enough, at times wanting to own one and compromising on the size and quality of the design cannot be a good decision. So you should not be hasty in making a decision to buy a home. And this is what I mean when I say balance between emotional and investment quotient. Mm-hmm. If you haven't saved enough money, prefer ready to move in so that the EMI load does not kind of become stressful. Don't just go for basics, because you know of your current budget, you might go for basics and then you compromise, and it is a long-term decision and you have to live with it.
So you're saying that don't compromise on the basics just because you have want that pride to own a home. Fair enough. How do you then choose on that, what is the right quality? How do you really come to a good location, good developer, especially for under construction properties, Ashwinder? There's always that fear amongst home buyers. Will I get my project? How quickly will it get completed? In the two pandemics, we've already seen projects getting delayed and RERA allowing developers extra time to complete. Buyers continue to pay EMIs.
So actually, looking at the pandemic, the way people are looking at home has changed, Manisha. You are seeing that the first-time buyer is not compromising around 70% of the total homes being sold. What the buyer needs to look at is, I think integrated townships are going to be the way forward. You need to walk to work. You need to have open spaces. You need to have community living. You need to have good community, which is a good community, and a location which is kind of equidistant from the CBD as well as the airport, etc. When you look at the developer, step out, meet multiple developers. Construction quality is important. Check the financial stability of the developer, track record of previous project timelines, how were they delivered, research their websites, go to their other projects, and try to connect with some existing customers to find out how this developer is.
A very interesting aspect that you mentioned in your book is it's not always about the super built-up area or carpet area. I want to ask you, in a day and time when every inch makes a little bit of a difference, because you know you're working from home, you're studying from home, why would that not be important?
Actually, what is happening is, Manisha, when people start looking at this technical aspect, first of all, a layman can't figure out whether what is the carpet area, what is the super area they are going with, what is filed with the RERA, etc. What I mean is you have to look at the design of the house. How is the house designed? Is it giving you enough space, enough air, enough light? And then house is not just today where you live in. Yes, it is important. You need an extra room because you have to work from home. But because of work from home, it has become very important. What are the open spaces that you're getting after the quarantine, which is there? You know, the new product design can give you an extra room without compromising by giving you extra space, because a lot of space is getting wasted by developers who are not focusing on the product design and getting into the nitty-gritties of it.
So check and check more. Be extremely careful is what you're saying, and take a rational decision. Thank you so much, Ashwinder, for sharing those insights with us. I'm sure there are many more gems in the book itself, A to Z of Real Estate, and it's for home buyers, sellers, investors, and channel partners. That's it from me. Thanks so much for watching.